Chris Laverick on episode 119. We have the return of that most excellent German comedian, Henning Wehn. We talk free expression in comedy, what's actually funny on TV these days, and this absolute rollercoaster season that's been for our beloved Hastings United. Then we've got the SCOTT ISTHMIAN PREM fan roundtable, and it's a slightly weary one after that superb Sussex Cup semi-final win. Enjoy, SBTS fans. Now let's go to that funny bloke, Henning Wehn.
It gives me great pleasure to introduce episode 119 of the Sussex by the Sea podcast, and I have got the returning wonderful comedian and all-round lovely German, Henning Wehn, big Hastings fan as well. Henning, how are you this evening?
No complaints, Chris. How are you?
I'm A-OK, sir. Well, Henning's on. We're going to talk a little bit about Hastings, but we're also going to talk a little bit about comedy. Anyone who follows Henning on social media will know that has tried, I think, as best as he can to kind of push back against quite a lot of the, how can we say it, the kind of more authoritarian stuff that's going on in comedy, where people are being, particularly the pre, you know, where you've got a sign, oh, I won't offend anyone, all this bullshit.
Yeah. I mean, there's one reported case. There was one university, and they booked a comedy night, and they wanted everyone to sign a long old letter with do's and don'ts, and since you, there was nothing left by the end once you had signed all the letter away.
So, well, even mother-in-law jokes were gone.
Yeah. Or father-in-law, not even. No.
Oh, Jesus.
No. Couldn't laugh about the husband, nor the wife, nor the children, nor the grandparents. So, I mean, as you say, it's just authoritarian. I should never attempt to say a word with TH in it, but it's authoritarian, as you say. So, and the saddest thing about it is when, say, someone isn't allowed to do his job, like, I don't know, say Jerry Sadovitz last year at the Fringe in Edinburgh when his run was cancelled after one show because some usherer didn't like it. It's just absolutely bizarre. And then the most bizarre thing about that is when you then see other comics coming out in favour of such a stance and saying, oh, it's really good that he's not allowed to do that. And I say, don't you realise that you might be next?
That's what I don't understand. I mean, that, you know, I mean, anyone, particularly Jerry Sadovitz, if anyone's ever seen him, the man, he offends everyone in equal measure.
The show was called Not For Anyone.
Yeah. And he does have a thumb time, doesn't he? He does get his chap out occasionally. I seem to remember he goes there. So you would expect that anyone seeing that performance would be kind of a little bit pre-warned that actually this guy's pretty full on.
And then he mentioned cancelling his run because of someone who works there didn't like it.
I know. Incredible.
And then and that is all because they're all not paid the living wage. So essentially they've got a lot more power because for the wages, what the venue, so certainly at the Fringe, so there is lots of great venues up and down the country, but the Fringe is particularly dodgily run. So, pay your staff the living wage and then you won't have nonsense like that. And then if someone doesn't want to work at that shift, tell them to do one and get someone else to do the shift.
I did actually, Jerry Sadovitz, I saw something funny about him recently that he was sent a Q&A. I don't know if you've seen this one yourself. One of the things was, if you weren't a comedian, that's one of the questions. If you weren't a comedian, what would you be? And he said Frankie Boyle, which I thought was quite funny.
yeah, it's no love lost there. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, talking about that, so we're going into kind of in a roundabout way. Like, I know that this stuff had been coming for a while. I remember, like, say, particularly Rowan Atkinson back in the day, well, at least 10-ish years ago, was kind of talking about that kind of free speech type stuff. Me mentioning free speech doesn't mean we're all Nazis, by the way, anyone listening, that you cannot, particularly a creative art form, you cannot put boundaries on it. The more and more you put boundaries on that, the more homogenized and dull it becomes. Mm. Maybe I'm not the right age anymore, but like, I seem to think that particularly the great comedies have kind of faded over the last is sort of 10 to 15 years. You know, like I could reel off stuff up to sort of the end of the 90s, 2000s, where you had some fantastic comedy that would last forever. And it seems like those days have kind of gone in terms of the stuff that's produced in England.
Yeah, I mean, when people say that, and I'm not saying at all you're wrong, but I sometimes think when you say, oh, yeah.
Fascist. Sorry.
Yeah, back on, in the day was Hancock's Half Hour or Only Fools and Horses. And then, but at the time, we remember only the great ones. There were loads of shit ones being made as well back then. And it's just you only remember the good ones. So, and I think, look, going forward 30 years, people will be remembering great sitcoms that are being made now. I mean, I don't know.
Are you serious? Really?
Yeah.
Are you in them, Henning? Is this a sitcom that you're in or anything? Because
No, but someone like Not Going Out, amusing.
Okay.
If you like Derry Girls, definitely good. Mm. This Country, absolutely fantastic. So, and the IT Crowd, good Father Ted is good few years ago.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That I'm with you there. And like Toast to London. Yeah, I think that was good. I just like,
Detectorists, that's not a bad one, is it?
Which one?
The Detectorists, there with Mackenzie Crook.
No, I've not seen that. I'll have to check this one out.
I think at all times there were a lot of, because a lot of the stuff from back in the day, if you just tune in, it's not very good. That just didn't stand the test of time. I mean, even like Ernie and
Malcolm and Wise.
Morecambe and Wise, I mean, that's borderline unwatchable, isn't it?
Some of it's all right. Oh, but, well, okay, well, what's your opinion on, say, someone like Les Dawson then? Because he was in the same era.
Seen enough of him to really have an opinion, but he's funny, isn't he?
He is funny. Yeah, you're not allowed to not find him funny. Otherwise, you'll get a free match ban. No, I agree. I mean, again, it could be, as you say, I'm prepared to take that on board that, yeah, you do remember the iconic shows, like you say, your Blackadders, your Red Dwarfs, young ones, like particularly say someone like Rick Mail.
The young ones, that didn't stand the test of time, did it?
Oh, come on.
Oh, it's borderline unwatchable.
The young ones is unwatchable. Are we Neil Orange Peel? Are we serious?
How in any steps prior to his mattress and all that? Oh, give me a break.
And like, what about when he takes all the laxatives? He's trying to kill himself and his bum explodes. No, come on. Henning.
That's quality
comedy.
We agree on it's not as good as what people say how good it is.
Are you talking to that? I am an absolute obsessively massive Rick Mail fan. So, Filthy Rich and Cat Flap may have not aged well, but young ones. But we'll agree to disagree. Can we do that, Henning?
We can always do that.
We could do that. So, I mean, yeah, as I started off with you, so you know, we've talked about this. This that hasn't been in comedy before, which is the kind of, I know it's a strong word, but authoritarianism or whatever words we're trying to say is that the
and it comes from within comedy. The industry. That's the strangest thing. Mm. It comes from within the industry.
And so what is the impact there, though? Because it must be like, I'm sure, like most things, you talk to fellow comedians that will, without, so informally will say, look, I know this is a load of old rubbish, you know, but we need work, so we've got to kind of go along with it type stuff. I mean, have you found that? Because obviously you've worked for, you know, you've done some work with the BBC and various other places. Do you find it's kind of like
that? I think there is both. I think there is some people who, like you are saying, are calculating about it. But I think there is some people who genuinely think it's a good idea.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, I find that baffling.
Yeah, so do I. Comedy should be able to it isn't about offending a certain group or anything. It should just be free reign. You should have free reign within reason, obviously.
I mean, if it's hate speech, well, that's obviously. I mean, if something breaks the law, or if someone,
depends what country you're in. If you're in Scotland,
anything can break the law now.
So
if someone says, "Let's leave the building and start a race riot," now that's not all right, because that's breaking the law. Every venue, they're obviously running their business. Mm. So if they book a mixed bill show with a promoter and they don't know who is on that mixed bill show, that's quite common. So like, say, Chris Laverick, you book once a month, you book a comedy night at White Rock. So, and it's called Chris's Comedy Club. So, and then you always book the act. Mm. And say then 1 month you book, say, Graham Linham. Online, yeah. However he's pronounced. So, and
for the people that don't know him, that's the person who did Father Ted and IT Crowd, and was it called Black Book? Yeah.
So, and he's very, he essentially reckons if you've got a cock, you can't be a woman. So that's essentially what he's best known for. Now, if your audience to 90% consists of that demographic, and then you throw him on in their venue. Well, they are saying the number of pints we're selling that evening will be outweighed by the number of pints we're not going to sell in the future, because our core crowd will hold the booking against us. Then you then cancel that performance from a venue's point of view. I fully understand.
Mm.
So if it's like for commercial reasons, but if it's for some reason, some bizarre reason of trying to be right on, that is just absolutely absurd.
But my issue is it shouldn't be the case. It should be that, you know, what happened to, if I don't like an act, I just don't go and watch it.
Absolutely.
And not, I want that person to lose that booking. I want that, and I'm going to try and shut the venue down by contacting their advertisers. And but like the how far it goes now.
I mean, we've seen it now again with Paul Curry at Soho Theatre about what did or didn't happen. Now, I've spoken to the story about that he kicked to a few Israelis out the venue.
Mm.
Now, I don't know exactly what did and what didn't happen, but I've spoken to him after about it. And the version he tells me, I mean, he has been doing that show 200 times without any upheaval and five-star reviews right, left and center. And all of a sudden, because of an incident which might or might not have happened, and certainly in all likelihood didn't quite the way it was portrayed by the media, he's become persona non grata and lost his gigs in the UK, lost his tour of Australia, lost his job at the clowning school in Belfast. So, and then you think, over what?
Yeah, well, when that culture's, like you said, like how it comes back and bites people.
But then you have to understand, if I was the clown school in Belfast and one of my teachers was implicated in being anti-Semitic, and then on a national level, on an international level even, well, you would have, as a business, you have to make then the decision, say, we can't have him teach here because it's more hassle than it's worth. And then as a business, you're almost forced into cutting your ties.
Well, yeah, but that's just because someone says someone is anti-Semitic. But by the way, there is anti-Semitism in the world. Before anyone thinks that I might not think that, I think we probably both agree on that, you know, just because someone says something, that doesn't make it real. And perception, say that issue, the Israeli issue, any like say Zionism, things like that, you should be allowed to criticize those things, like should be able to criticize other religions and other ideologies.
Yeah, the broader point was more like that was trying to make is, once the news is out there like that, a business almost has got no alternative to saying, I'll cut my ties with person X, Y, or Z, because if they don't, it's all ending up on their doorstep.
Well,
so, and then you think as a business, yeah, you can be upstanding and you can be supportive of whoever is being accused, but that will be at a great cost to yourself, to your business.
Yeah, but I mean, it depends if you think they're false claims or not. I mean, it depends. It, like, as you know, in the media, there's certain trigger issues. that people will, they will crack down on, and there'll be other issues which they will almost ignore. And because it, well, because the world isn't a fair place. But, and you know, that it, we have, you know, there has been places that have stood up for, you know, for people and fought against this, but they're very few and far between.
Well, and then that standing up is their business model.
Yeah.
So then you can say, how altruistic is that? Because it's just their business model saying, oh, we're booking all the people who are the outcasts. Now, I'm in favor of that because at least they can earn a living. But it's again just a way of working on your brand as a venue, saying we are booking the people that aren't allowed to perform anywhere else. Well, that becomes your USP. And everyone knows, oh, they're edgy. Let's go and watch what they've got on.
Well, again, it's the power of the customer. If you're going to have venues that kick people out and don't have them because they upset whatever morality or ideology that that they want to push all of a sudden in a comedy venue, all the power to the other venues that pick them up and give them a platform. In my book, it's, you know, again,
yeah, absolutely. But again, it's a business decision as well, isn't it?
Well, if it makes you money, yeah.
Who does pick you then up?
Because the venues that are going to be like that. Well, I personally hope that sort of thing. I mean, if you're going to sit there and ban people for whatever reason, be it left wing, right wing, whatever, because of ideology or whatever, because it's not a safe space for them. If you lose money because less people come to your venue because the place isn't as funny, or people get the perception that you're killing the comedy market, you're killing creativity. Well, that's on you, isn't it, really? I mean, it's more the power to any venue that does it. And of course, they're going to try and monetize it. Because, I mean, that's actually, we're moving on to something I wanted to ask you, which was, what is the comedy scene like at the moment? I know that obviously that you've coming back from COVID, you know, in terms of venues, in terms of, has it picked back up? You know, I know you've...
Yeah, I know there is certain other issues. Sales have picked up, definitely, because during COVID and post-COVID, the difficulty was that a lot of people still had fridge tickets, as they were known, fridge tickets, because it was tickets that were bought long time ago for shows that were then being postponed. And once someone had five sets of fridge tickets, and how they were unlikely to buy another pair of tickets for something. So they waited until they had all gone. So that meant if you listed a show or put a show up for sale tickets for sale after COVID, they didn't go very well because people still had so many unused tickets at home. So, yes. But they've all been used up. And I would say the market is in rude health. A lot of the venues do struggle with the energy prices.
Okay.
Because their overhead's gone up massively. And if you have got a theater with God knows how much light and God knows how much heating, their overheads are sensational. Like electricity prices, which is one of the main expenses in a venue, if that's been tripled, which has in many cases, then all of a sudden, well, there is a good chance you go under, and a few venues have gone under.
Okay. And so, like, I know you had some issues with the Fringe. Is that a place that you would go back to, or what's your situation with the Edinburgh Fringe at the moment, Henning?
Look, I've been there from 2004. I've been there every year from 2004 until 22. And last year was the first year I didn't go, because 2 years ago I thought I didn't enjoy it for the first time. And if you don't enjoy something, it's no point going. So, and I'm not saying I'm never going back or nothing. I like Edinburgh. I like watching Hearts. And I like it for cycling. I like playing pitch and putt there in the town centre. That's all great. But they've got a massive housing shortage. And we obviously know about that in Hastings as well. But they've got massive housing shortage. And that's now showing its face, rearing its face, definitely with the rent for the month. So I was looking for this year just to get an idea.
Yeah.
And I saw a 2-bedroom flat, normal flat. So nothing special, $9,000 for the month.
Fucking hell. Oh, okay. All right. I thought it was a bit pricey there, but not that.
So, and then I thought,
tent. So it's a tent.
Well, they have got, what they have started, you'll laugh, Chris, they have in Musselburgh, which is a good few miles outside Edinburgh, they have unearthed some student accommodation where you can then stay. But the difficulty there is obviously then you rely on public transport to get in and out late at night. That's a no starter. If, say, you have got two shows a day, your own show in the evening, and you want to do something else work-wise midday, you have got nowhere to stay in between. So that's not really feasible either.
What's happening with the fringe? Because I mean, we you know, we touched on the kind of,
well, it's getting bigger and bigger. There's more shows on.
I know, but like, if people can't afford to stay there and have a run, which is like, obviously there's lots of comedy and performances that go to the fringe that are, should we say, out there, and if you can't afford those types of people, that more and more will not be able to go there.
No, that's right. You have to be moneyed. You have to be moneyed. Either you have to have the money from home, that your parents give you the money, or you have to be on good earnings. You have to be a fully established act. So if you're not ticking either of those two boxes, I can't see how you can afford it.
And the fringe are not trying to do anything about that? I mean, or is it they're just more interested in just making a bit of few quid or...
They try something here or there, but if there is no accommodation, there is no accommodation. So they could say, yeah, we build lots of tents, we pitch up lots of tents on the meadows, but it'd be shite as well, wouldn't it? Let's be honest. Let's live in a tent for months. That's rubbish. So I don't know what they can do.
Could comedy prison ships, you know, you could.
Yeah, send the one from Portland, send that up the coast. Yeah.
Now we're getting on to the good stuff. Talking of things that Henning loves. Henning, a bit of a massive Hastings fan like me. So I do bump into him occasionally. Last time I bumped into him, we were with some annoying Horsham fan.
Yes, that's right.
Yes, what a lovely
And
person.
I still haven't made it up to your box.
Hey. And well, actually, it goes straight to a question that old Windy Gale, John Gale, asked me, because I reached out to the Hastings fans, and as usual, in their masses of one person that sent me a request, I said what we were going to be talking about. And all he says is this: are you main stand?
I'm main stand all day, every day.
Je suis main stand. So you need... What you need to do, Henning, is you need to go to the PA box where Flat White Andy is, who does the videos. You know, with Aggie, I don't know if you've seen any of those videos.
Yeah.
And get your Je suis main stand badge, as you definitely
please.
Earn that.
Absolutely.
So, funny enough...
with the Nutters and their drum.
No, that's... We're not in the main stand. We're not allowed
exactly.
there.
I'm
We're
not standing with the nutters
exactly.
and the drum.
Oh, yeah, sorry, I didn't hear you. Yeah, well, talking of nutters, we're all lovely. But Ashford was the last game Hastings played. Unfortunately, we lost on pens. Yeah. It's so funny that I'm now talking to you as obviously the famous Ashford game where you were in cycling shorts and wonderful...
Are you taking fans away?
And the wonderful, awesome Sir Gary Histed was in his mankini. Since then, we've had no games. So we've got anything to talk about.
Are you taking fans away?
Stop. Sorry. you had to be there for that one.
I'm asking is, are you taking fans away?
Oh, God. What a day that was. What a day. an awesome game.
Saw the footage, by the way, from the Ashford game, where you got the Ashford fella, and he was doing all the singing for Hastings as well.
Oh, that was beautiful. Yeah, I mean, yes, he was a really, really nice guy, actually. He wouldn't go away. He was like one of those sort of relatives at Christmas who just won't stop talking to you. But he joined in with our songs because the Ashford lot weren't really making much noise. Unfortunately, the buggers beat us. But, you know, that's where it goes sometimes. Henning, let's talk this season. Now, this season has been, the beginning. Asking you, because I'm completely biased, asking you, what did you think about the changes, Paul Barnes coming in, and how did you feel that all went?
Well, when Paul Barnes put out, by all accounts, lovely fella. But then when he put out that statement before his first game, the mission statement, how he wanted it all to go in writing, and he was littered with spelling mistakes, and then it all made very little sense. And then you think, oh, mate, just get the bips out.
Mm.
So, and then really, just really overcomplicated nonsense.
Yeah.
And then they decided then to, so they lost all the players when they told them that they're going to train in London.
Yeah.
And then they train in London, then they lose obviously all the Hastings-based players.
Yeah.
And then Paul Barnes leaves, they train back here again. They're essentially on their third squad for one season.
I know. It's crazy.
So, and considering that, it's going very well with the playoffs still in reach. And it's great to have Aggie back, where I still don't quite understand how that happened. Because when Chris left, he left with a reputation to rival Guardiola.
He'd love to hear that. I'll have to tell him that.
So, and then he goes to Stevenage. Then he had just started at Stevenage to ESSEX their manager. All of a sudden, he is leading out their first team squad in the, was it league game or cup game?
I think it was the FA Cup. I think it was. I could be wrong.
And then you think, is he going to be the manager now? And because you're still in your head that he's essentially level par with Guardiola. So, and now he's back at Hastings. What's that all about?
Mm. He couldn't get away from us. He couldn't get away from us, Henning, could he? I mean, what an awesome fan base we are.
Absolutely, absolutely. More supporters than Stevenage,
absolutely.
That's for sure. And what with Aggie I found funny, when I've got a good mate who used to be, did you remember the story in Hartlepool when they voted the mascot in, Angus the Monkey?
Yeah.
And that's Stuart Drummond, and he's a good mate of mine.
Oh, excellent.
So, and they'd sacked their manager, Hartlepool, and I had Stuart on the phone, and I said, get a rumour going, then, because it was like, then who are they looking at? So, I said, get a rumour going, they're looking at Chris Agata from Hastings. And he managed to make that so successful that by the end, Aggie was 6-1, still a 6-1 to become the manager of Hartlepool.
That's what I mean. The power, Henning, the power you have, you were just, yeah. Well, what does that say about news in general? If it's just start a rumor and But yeah, so I mean, we've got this Sussex Cup game coming up against Littlehampton, the might of Littlehampton. Littlehampton, it always reminds me of a Spike Milligan joke, but I don't know how much of a fan of Spike Milligan you are. Do you remember the one where there's a man having a bath and Spike comes through the water?
No.
And okay, it's
but I've read his book the other day that said he's written
which one? Oh, which one though? Because he's wrote loads.
Oh, the My Part in Hitler's Downfall,
yeah, okay, yeah, because it's My Part in his Downfall, His Part in My Downfall, I've got a few, but he's absolutely brilliant, yeah. So we've got Littlehampton in the cup. I mean, can you see us? Can you see us making the playoffs? Can you see us getting to that Sussex Cup final?
Yeah, I don't know about the Sussex Cup final, but the playoffs, yeah, they're well within reach. I mean, they've changed slightly the last two home games. The attacking play seemed to predominantly be Ollie Black throwing balls into the box.
Well, he's got such a weapon on him, he can throw balls into the box easily.
Yeah, but then you think after that happened for the third time, the other team are aware of it. So, and then there's like 20 players in the box, and then it's obviously very difficult then to score from that. And it's all, I found that, and Chris will have perfectly sensible reason. He knows 100 times more about football than me. There will be a very good reason why they're doing it. But I felt that was a bit underwhelmed by that approach.
Well, yeah, you in the main stand. So, yep, the Boo Boys. It is an exciting end to the season. I never thought, after what I consider a nightmare, and any fan that knows me knows that I thought the whole Paul Barnes stuff was well, anyway, let's not go there. But like, for us to be in this situation, I find incredible. I just think we're really lucky. I just think we've got away with it there. A lot of other clubs could be, we'd be rooted to the bottom, but it's fantastic that we got people that actually care.
Oh, absolutely.
That, you know, involved and yeah. So, well, Hennig, look, listen, what wonderful, because a little birdie cheap was in my ear telling me that you're testing out some new material for your tour. Where are you going to be out and about?
Here, there, everywhere. Yeah. New Haven, Peacehaven, Lewes, how you name it, Brighton. So all over East Sussex.
But not Hastings.
No, never shit on your own.
Never shit on your own doorstep. For anyone listening or who's going to be watching, what do they go on to have a look at your tour dates and things like that?
Oh, it's just my website, henningwehn.de.
Okay, lovely. Before you go, how's your shell cook getting on?
I mean, if you think you're getting 60,000 people every week,
mm.
and you're almost rooted to the bottom of the table in the second tier, that is just not very good. I mean, we will be staying up now. I think we've got a 4-point gap. I think that, if anything, will start to increase, but very disappointing.
Okay. Who's in charge at Schalke these days?
Hmm?
Who's in charge at Schalke?
Well, on board level, an old schoolmate of mine.
Oh, really?
Axel Hefer. Yeah. He's the chairman of the board, and he's that's also, it's great for him and whatnot, because he comes from the ultra side of things.
So he's a bit emotional.
And he's probably liaising with people, yeah, you wouldn't want in charge of anything. So that is so essentially, like, if the bloke with the drum became
George?
Chairman.
Yeah. If George became chairman, that could be. He's lovely, George.
Yeah.
He's a classical teacher. He is. He's a classical music teacher. Thank you.
Oh, yeah, you can hear.
No, but
nothing against George, but it's just like I think the chairman wants to come from the main stand.
On that bombshell. On that bombshell. No, Hennig, thank you for coming on, and it's always a pleasure. And when's the next Hastings game you can make? I know you weren't too sure about the semi-final, but
I looked it up. Put it in my clever book. I can do the 16th.
Yeah, that's the Saturday, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because we're going to have about a million Tuesday games as well. So I don't know.
Yes, which is very handy for me.
Oh, excellent. Okay, well, 16. I'll give Andy a shout, and I'll tell him to get your badge, your main stand badge, ready.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, yeah. I'll be wearing it with pride.
Yeah. We'll have to get a behind the goal badge going, but I don't know how well that will go down with the rest of them. Henning, thank you very much. Always
thank
a pleasure.
Thank you very much, Chris.
And take care.
Aggie, I love you. Thanks for coming back all the way from Stevenage.
All right, mate. Take care.
Bye, Chris. Yeah. Thank
Cheers,
you.
Mate.
Bye. Stayed all night.
to you, babe. Just gotta get through. Ooh, I can see lamplight shining from your window. Baby, see lamplight and it shine on me. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine on me.
And now we have the SBTS ISTHMIAN PREM FAN ROUNDTABLE. Many, many thanks to Ian, Terry and John for making it happen.
Gives me great pleasure to introduce episode 119 of the ISTHMIAN PREM FAN ROUNDTABLE. Wonderful guests, Ian, John and Terry from Haringey, Canvey and Margate. We were going to have a few more people on, but there's been lots of stuff happening in their lives, so they couldn't make it, but they're all okay. So first of all, hello everyone, how are you this evening?
Hello. Evening, Chris.
Bit of a delay there, mate. Yeah, thank you. We're all good. Yes, a slow one. I should be the one that's slow here because I'm still recovering from that Sussex Cup semi-final victory that I won't talk about at least 8 times today. So I'm a little bit weary. So I'm hoping you lot do more of the chat than me today. But let's go straight into a certain Ian. Let's talk Haringey. Let's talk about what's not been a bad little run at the moment.
No, it came to it like a run of three wins on the spin for the first time since as long as I can remember, really. So. In all competitions, but the run came to an end last night when we lost to Hashtag United in the Velocity semi-finals. Apparently, I didn't go, but I'm reliably informed that we were robbed. very, very dubious winner, which should have been disallowed, and a very soft penalty. But before that, we had beat Margate in the league at home, our second home win of the season. And then we followed that up on the Tuesday night with I didn't go to that one either. Followed that up on a Tuesday night by beating Whitehawk in the Velocity Trophy. And then followed that up with a washout against Potters Bar. But on Saturday, we beat Chesant for the second time this season. So we that's now 25% of our points this season in the last two games.
And 18 bragging rights as well, so...
Yeah, I mean, 25% of our points this season have come from Chesant as well. So
that's it. But that's a key win, really, isn't it? Relegation battle, isn't it?
If we hadn't won both of those, I would have given up and I'd have said we're down. But as it is now, there's a glimmer of hope.
Yeah. What we're saying, it is close, isn't it? Chesant are definitely in. It's just Chesant, though, isn't it? Really, they're it's either going to be
The thing about Chesant is they still have like 2 or 3 quite winnable games. So I think they're going to get probably about 10 more points this season. So we need to get, 15 more points this season to pip them. And I think it's Chesant who are probably the team to beat. I feel like we're going to finish second or third in this like little 5-team mini league.
Yeah.
But the Chesant game was also notable for Ole Durojaiye making his like 12th, 13th debut for Haringey. It's slightly ridiculous. I'm not entirely sure how many times he's been back, but he leaves and then midway through the season he'll be back. And he's lasted until March this time around before making his Haringey debut. I think he was at Weymouth, but yeah, it was good to have him back. He was an absolute menace. Scored the only goal of the game. Constantly made a nuisance of himself in the middle of the pitch. Forgot how much I'd missed him. I think everybody was a little bit sceptical when they were like, he's back again. But won over the doubters very quickly.
Yeah, well, when you get a goal, you sort of doubters out. Well,
Saying that, Ian, so were you at the Margate game?
I missed that.
No,
I was, can't remember what I was doing, on international duty, maybe. I think it was the women's international break then.
Mm.
But yeah, that was a really, really good win as well. And I think it's the little bit of luck that I think we probably haven't had, like against Chesant as well. It was like...
Well, moving on to you then, John. Canvey have not had a good run of things at the moment, and you're not going to be involved in any relegation battle. I mean, what's your thoughts on what's been the kind of worrying kind of last few results, really?
Yeah, no, it's not been great. I mean, as you say, I don't think we're going to obviously get sucked into anything bad now. I mean, we're still 15 points above drop zone. So I think really, realistically, we only need about sort of 5 or 6 more points probably to guarantee that sort of safety net mathematically. But no, it's not been a good run. I mean, ironically, I think it's since I've come back from being abroad. So I'm pending my application to do a bit of missionary work in the Marshall Islands. I'll be in the National League by the time I come back, mark my words.
Yeah.
No, it's not been particularly great. And it's a shame, really, because we seem to, I don't know, in the last couple, we've sort of had a few signs of improvement. I mean, obviously, the Carl Sharlton one, we were unlucky not to win. Lewis away, we showed a good bit of fight to come back into that. I mean, I know you messaged me after that one, didn't you, Chris, about the time we were enjoying about pegging Lewis back. And, you know, I mean, I thought that was a fairly sort of evenish game. I mean, you could probably say as a neutral, they sort of edged the play. But sort of last 15, 20 minutes of the game, I mean, we were all over them. And we kind of got what our performance merited, really. I mean, we got that equaliser sort of right bang on the 90th minute. Cracking little goal from Sam Higgins. I mean, for a man of his size, I didn't quite think he could move like that. But I think he pretty much ended Ronnie Vint's career in just knocking the guy to the floor and going inside. So, you know, we were absolutely made up about that. And then it was just mad last 5 minutes. I say they scored 2 minutes later. And I turned around to one of the other boys there that day. I was just like, it's just the hope that kills you, innit? Yeah. Literally, you can't the other end, get a free kick, and he just levers it in, Higgins. So, you know, he left there feeling like a win, which is really good. Yeah. So, yeah, to kind of go on to Wingate as we did at the weekend, it's a shame we couldn't follow it up, really. And, you know, I mean, I thought it would be a much tougher game. I mean, I say that coming off back of a loss, really. There wasn't a great deal in it. I mean, considering where they were in the league, they looked about as mid-table as we did, really. But I think the key difference really was that they could take their chances while we couldn't. Obviously, I mean, the boy who obviously got their first goal, he was like the scourge of us away. So, I mean, thankfully, he didn't score 3 this time, just the one. So he was being a bit generous to us. I mean, the second goal was shrouded in a bit of controversy. I mean, I don't know, maybe I'm not as versed in the old referee's rule book as everyone else, but I think they sort of got it on the back of basically one of our boys had taken a clatter into the face and his tooth literally got knocked out. So he went down on his head. Like, I don't think he went down quite quick enough for the linesman to show any sympathy. So they just lobbed it up the other end of the field and we were already down to 10 men at that point anyway. So another one of our boys, our left back, he picked up a knock. I mean, we were waiting to make the substitution and yeah, they just got in and scored off of that. So it was a bit of controversy in that. But yeah, I mean, we didn't really create enough to warrant that, which is a worrying sign. I mean, because we got a striker in the team last year who scored, I mean, well, we've got the one who's for us who scored about 20 plus goals, and then you got Higgins who scored 30 odd goals. So it's kind of like, you know, we've got to try and find some way of getting them back firing a goal, really. But I don't know, it just seemed to be.
What do you think it is, John, though? What do you think? There's obviously such a drop off from last season. What do you think it?
I don't know. I mean, I think it's just been a series of factors, really. I mean, I'll probably have a better idea of sort of assessing it at the end of the season, but I don't know, obviously injuries for a start have killed us. I mean, not having our sort of key player, Evans Kouassi, in the side hasn't helped. So kind of it's almost like reinventing the wheel, really, in terms of how our formula was set up to play. I mean, we've had sort of stop-start with postponements throughout the season. I mean, I think that's obviously something that's killed quite a lot of teams, really. I don't even know, a season like it, as far as postponements go, has been mental. But yeah, I think as well as that, just sort of, I don't know, trying to bounce back from the sort of bad runs we've had, who just maybe not had the resolve to do it this year, which is a shame because a lot of the key players from last year are still there. But saying obviously are just, I don't know, gone wrong somewhere along the line. So I think it's been our scenario, it's just basically winding down the season, seeing maybe what works and what doesn't work, and assessing to go again next year. But obviously, I don't feel feel a lot of people were great with their confidence. I mean, I think there were sort of people who had sort of planned to do away days and that, who are dropping off now, and it's kind of like, yeah, just, I don't know, just try and give us Saints towards the end of the season, and yeah, we'll see where we are in the summer. But it's an odd one. It's kind of that whole classic second season syndrome. So it's an odd, it's an odd one. So one to assess in the summer, I think.
Yeah, yeah, fair enough. Well, we did, as I say, we did have Terry. I think Terry has officially left the building now. She did try. She's having technical issues. I know. I don't want to sort of talk bad once she's not here. But you think Margate? It's not looking good. I mean, I do like Margate, but it's not. I think
shame they can't play us every week. But no, it's not looking good for them. I mean, I would have generally thought after they beat us, maybe they'd go on and start picking up their form. I mean, the game before they played us, they run champ close. I mean, I always still try and keep an eye on the ups and downs of the league as well. But yeah, since then, it just doesn't seem to be clicking for them. And, you know, other sides starting to pick up, as you say, like Chess and Haringey picked up a few good results. So, I mean, the more and more they get sucked into it, you know, the harder it's going to be to get out. Obviously, a couple of games, didn't they, in hand, especially if it's Chess and one that keeps getting postponed. But what Concord having all their games in hand as well, it's going to be a tight finish, I think.
Yeah. What you were about to say, Ian?
Yeah, I think Kingstonian are gone. And I think it's just going to be one of us four. I think that's going to stay up. And my feeling at the moment is it's probably going to be Chesham, just because it's more in their hands than it is in any of the other teams.
Yeah.
I mean, I think for us to stay up, we basically need everybody to finish on us, Concord, Chesham, all get the same amount of points, Margate as well. And if we're just sort of the 1 point ahead of them, then we can stay up. But if like Chesham win two or three of their remaining games, they're probably outside. The same with Margate, really. I think it could be any one of us at the moment.
Yeah, that's definitely. I mean, as you say, John, I do like to look at the ups and downs of the league. I'm very surprised. I mean, we ourselves, John, I just thought you'd be having a much better season than you are, and it just shows.
We thought that as well, mate. Really, but it does kind of show the unpredictable nature of the league. Really, I mean, there are other sides I thought we might be up doing a bit more this season. I mean, I think at the start of the season, everyone thought that Dulwich might be in the sort of top three for most of the year, but they've kind of stuttered and started, haven't they? I mean, they might be able to sort of force an issue into the playoffs now, but it's kind of a bit more short of what I thought they'd be. But it's still a lot of interesting going on as we're in the sort of run up to the end of the season. I mean, obviously, as you say, Ian, the relegation race is a lot tighter than I think it may have been a couple of weeks ago. Obviously, you think it's advantage Chesham now, but obviously, they've got to make the most of that while they can.
Yeah. I mean, if they lose to Kingstonian on Saturday,
that's it. It blows the door wide open, doesn't it?
Yeah, and we beat Cray Wanderers, which, you know, they're losing tonight to Potter's Bar. I think they'll be hopefully knackered, hoping for a couple of knocks and a red card. We beat them by 17 goals. We're out of the relegation zone, so.
Well,
that's it, you know. I mean, it's still all there to play for. I mean, I think obviously a lot of people, particularly on the night, and they assess it on the Isthmian website, obviously they look at Concord and say, oh, they've got all these games in hand, so they could be the one to maybe force the issue. But they had a similar situation last year in the National South, and you know, I think it got to the point where they were playing so many games in succession, it just absolutely shot them down, really. They couldn't get the points they needed, and that killed them. So, you know, it's still all there to play for, really. So you just don't know. It's obviously who turns up now, who's got the bottle to see it through.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it's the same, really, playoff chase as well, isn't it?
Well, that's what I was going to go to, John, because obviously we had Billericay. We've had a load of cancellations, but we had Billericay on the Saturday. I unfortunately couldn't go. I listened to it on our radio, old Tom, who does the radio for us. Will Harley scored for us, a youngster who's just coming from the academy. Kind of, unfortunately, with the weather, how it's been, our pitch is really locked. It's gone to pot. Like, it's like, from what everyone that tells me, it's like if Shane Warne or Phil Edmonds, depending on how old we all are, but add a little bowl on it, it would be going everywhere. It's really bobbly, and obviously Hastings, that we for our sins, we do try and play it on the ground and that, and if your game's based on that and the ball's going everywhere, it's not going to help. But you know, again, and you look at Haringey, who I mean you know, you're thinking, how are they still up there? Like, you see Enfield out of the spots again. I thought Enfield were a shoe-in for the playoffs, but the playoffs are up to probably, well, I'm just looking at this now, and it's just, you think that no one's truly out of it, even down to sort of, say, sort of Bognor. But it's just about being consistent. And as you've said before, John, like, it's there's no team in this league, literally, that's consistent other than Hornchurch. And
that's it, exactly. I mean, it only really seems to be, like I say, them and possibly Chatham, really, that can pull ahead of anyone. I mean, even like sort of Horsham put together a really good run recently and then go to losing Carl Shelton at the weekend. I mean, it surprised me that Wingate got up as high as third. I didn't quite realise it was that tight until I saw the table afterwards. But it just goes to show, really, what that, how it can flip. And it was similar for us last season, really, because, I mean, we thought we were just about going to sneak in the playoffs. And then it only took, I think, Hornchurch and Stortford losing on a consecutive weekend for us to end up in the title race. So, yeah, and that was, you know, sort of late in March. So it's an absolute roller coaster. I mean, you kind of love it in a way, but you hate it if you're involved in it. It's just an absolute nightmare.
Well, I would really, really love it if we beat Chatham on Saturday, because they're coming to our place. Hopefully the rain don't ruin that, because we bloody weather's been awful. But it's a massive game for Hastings. I mean, if we don't get any result from that, then I think that's our playoff hopes put to bed. Myself, I'm sure others will jump on me and say, no, it's too early to say that. But we've really got to start picking points up against these teams. Just quickly, gentlemen, I've got to mention it again. Sorry, just Sussex Cup semi-final, which was in Lancing against Littlehampton. I just want to mention it for anyone that's listening. 3-0. I predicted 3-0. I also said that David Rodari is going to get a few. What I didn't do is I didn't bet it. I didn't put a bet on. So I didn't gain any money from this. It was just...
Can you bet on the Sussex Senior Cup?
Well, you can bet. You can bet on the... obviously, in the our league, you can... So I didn't even look, to be honest. I was too busy having a bit of a sing-off with the Littlehampton fans to put my bet on. So, but yeah, just quickly, Littlehampton, they put up a good fight. It was simply just that little bit of extra quality that we had that was the difference, really. And that's why we, you know, particularly David Rodari, who's having a great season, and he was just too good for them. Decent turnout. I don't like Lancing. I've never liked that ground. I don't know why we've got to go all the way there to play a semi-final. But we're off to the Amex. Hastings boys and girls were in good voice. It was an excellent away day. I am still recovering from it. So, yeah.
Sign of a good away day.
Yeah, no, it was a good one. The chaps got me home, so yeah, I was deposited in my house last night. So, but yeah, a great day, and well done everyone involved with the club who's got us there. First time in 26 years that we've got to the final. So we don't know a date, but that's going to be a good one. That's at Brighton. So, but yeah,
time to lobby for a County Cup Winners' Cup. Yeah. I think it would be great. Like, everybody who wins a County Cup gets to play in a competition. Winner gets the Champions League spot.
Do you know what I mean? I'm willing to take that
on. Funny enough, sort of off topic, well, I say off topic, it's all about County Cup. I've always sort of said amongst a couple of the boys I watch Canvey with, we'd like to think of ourselves football aficionados, we've had a few beers. But I would love if we adopted a sort of similar model to what they have out in Germany. Because out there you have state cups. And basically, whoever wins their state cup, whether they could be, I don't know, sort of one of the bigger teams or like a lowly, I don't know, Oberliga side out there, equivalent to our like Ismian League, they earn themselves an automatic place in the first round of the German Cup. So that means that they've got an eligible place to play someone like, I don't know, like Bayern Munich or Borussia Dortmund at home.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I think that would give, I don't know, particularly when you see sort of sides here, some take it seriously, others don't. I think it would put a lot more sort of steam and incentive really into sides wanting to win their County Cup. Because, I mean, obviously it can be a really good achievement, as you say. It's for yourselves, Chris, it's a chance to go to the Amex, you know, sort of big evening out under the lights, and it's a bit of silverware at the end of the day. So it's good when, as you say, you see your side take it seriously. It's something nice to look back on at the end of the season. But if you had that little bit of extra spice, just for me, I think it would make a lot better. Say, if you had maybe an automatic first round place in the FA Cup, I think that would be a good incentive for teams going forward. But we'll leave that to the FA to decide whether they get around in the next 100 years.
I was going to say, you beat me to it, yeah.
That's it.
But yeah, obviously, I didn't even mention we've got Horsham. Horsham, that's going to be a tough game. So Horsham are a very good side. Again, you know, they're in that sort of playoff hunt. But who knows? I mean, that's what I mean. You just don't know at the moment, do you? Nothing's settled. I mean, other than Kingstonian, in my eyes, nothing is settled in this league. And Hornchurch, obviously. But
poor Kingstonian.
Yeah. I mean, if Hornchurch could pull that back like they did against Bognor at the weekend, like was that 95th and 98th minute they scored? I mean, that boy scored from that Lewis Manor. I mean, he was a really good striker last year and got himself moved to the National South. So they must be forking out a decent wedge for him. That's what I'm going to say.
Well, yeah.
But, you know, if you can do it, you've got that resource, you go for it.
Yeah, I've heard that they're spending big, spending serious money. But, yeah, okay. Yeah,
Michael, I don't think he drives a Ferrari now.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I've been a sort of Canvey fan. In our history, I can't really say much because we were that side at one point back in the old Jeff King days. That was Canvey, the sort of envy of a lot. We were a nothing club until then, so yeah, that's it. It's as you say, playoffs still very much open. I mean, I don't know who's got who in the run up sort of this weekend.
Well, we've got a massive game. I think it's probably one of our most winnable games left, home to Crane Wanderers. So yeah. I think. We win that and we give ourselves. So the last few games have very much been like eliminators in that if we don't win them, we're probably stumped. And I think this is probably like, it's the first game where we can kind of, if we win that, we might be not stuffed.
Mm. Yeah, because we've also got Hornchurch, Billericay. You'd expect obviously Hornchurch to turn them over. And then that might open if there's a few wins underneath that sort of play at the playoff places that might pull Billericay out of it. You've got Dulwich versus Lewis. Oh, what a game, eh? You imagine that.
The Waitrose Derby.
Yeah, so there's the big Waitrose Derby. And obviously, like, you got Cheshunt Concord, which is...
Yeah, that's another big one.
That's a big one.
Cheshunt only smacked them just recently, actually. I know they played that ain't they, didn't they, in the end? But, that's another interesting one.
Well, yeah,
Enfield Horsham is a big game.
Yeah, yeah.
And Cheshunt Concord is a massive game in the relegation fight.
So I mean, got some cracking fixtures coming up Saturday, didn't we? So
like I say, just hope it's been wet for the place off and forget. It's the most mad season I've known for a while in regards to postponements. Anyone on grass just screwed. I mean, this is the most we've had in years because normally our pitch is one of the better grass ones in the sort of local area because we were lucky enough to have like a really good training system put in under sort of Jeff King days, but even our grounds when he just sort of turned up on Tuesday, because we were meant to have Horsham, and literally it was just puddles everywhere. Yeah. You know, it would have made for a cracking game of water polo, but football, nah, without question. But above today, literally, we've had no rain today, and it's all drained. So it seems to pick the most inconvenient times to want to do it.
Do you drain your pitch onto Concord's?
It'll make for a great solution, to be fair, but I think they're already miserable enough down there, so I don't know.
It is funny seeing their Twitter and all that, you know, because you see people posting about, because obviously the whole thing with Concord, always getting games cancelled. There's always people teasing them about it.
You know what? Have you seen that little joke poster goes around? Like, say the line, Concord.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the Simpsons one, isn't it?
We made that up and chucked it into onto Twitter, and basically it's just taken on life its own since.
Yeah.
It's,
I couldn't find that one. I did a different one. I couldn't find you'll have to send me that one day.
Send me in.
Well, hang on, we got Terry back. Terry.
Yeah, I don't know if I'm working or not.
No, we can hear you.
No, you're right. Working, definitely.
We can always hear you, Terry.
Yeah, excellent.
Right, in a nutshell, right, Margate.
We're all gone.
Where have you got? You're in Margate, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm just trying to find the bloody screen. this is just horrific, this new thing. It's just awful.
Technology, mate.
There we go. Right, you're back. I've got your lovely face. Yeah, Margate, well, I've pretty much resigned myself to being relegated. So, yeah, it's we've won one game since November. It's not for want of trying. So, yeah, I've just resigned.
You think it's done? You think it's done, yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, I really do, because with the effort we're putting in, that's the trouble. The boys are putting the effort in, and we're still not producing. it's gutting.
Well,
Shane can't play us every week, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, literally, we've won the one game since November, and that's it. We pulled it back from 4-0 down the other day, but, you know, it's still not enough. Two goals ain't enough.
You never know. You never know, do you? You've got... There's still that Chessant. There's still Chessant there. I mean, it might be other Cubs, but, you know, it could be...
Well, the fact that the game was off means we can actually get Harry Hudson back on, because he ended up with concussion at the last game. Steve was out injured. Tyler's out injured. Tyrone's out injured. And Blackie's on a ban because he got a red.
Okay.
So we've got a thin squad as it is. So, yeah.
Well, you let Don Vos go. What happened there then?
Oh, I don't know. I don't think he fitted in, really.
No.
I don't know. We've got a couple of better players in, let's put it that way.
Well, so what, no chance against Carl Shorten Saturday then, you think?
I can't remember the last time we beat them. It was about 2016.
Yeah. I've never known you this negative, Terry.
Well, you know, it's when you get one game since November, it does tend to take its toll.
Yeah, that's fair enough. Well,
just realistic, I suppose, you know. I'm still going to be there. I'm still going to cheer them on every week, like there's hope. But
the saving grace is there are five teams in this league who are absolutely dreadful. And that's the comfort I'm taking. It's that, yes, we are bad at football, but there are four other teams who are just as bad. And one of us is going to stay.
I'll take that. I wouldn't mind if we weren't actually, you know, some of the performance, when we can string a couple of passes together and that, it looks good football, but it's just not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't think it's done yet. As I was just saying before, you while you were off, that Kingstonian, done. Hornchurch, up. Other than that, it's all up for grabs.
I mean, like I say, don't get me wrong, I will still be there behind the goal, cheering them on as if we've got a chance. And I'm never going to let my boys down. I'm always going to be there encouraging them, but it's just getting really hard.
It's done, isn't it? I mean, even, with your record at Coleshorten, you could go there and they might have a bit of pressure on their shoulders. They want to stay in the playoff race, so... Anything can happen, you know. I think that's what you've got to try and think. I mean, I generally think the Canvey's going to win another game before the end of the season, but what do I know? It's not like them, isn't it? I'm happy with draws. Anything can happen.
Yeah, realistically, I've sort of like, yeah, okay, new grounds next season, do you know what I mean? But, yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, particularly this Saturday, there's some cracking games. So more will be revealed on Saturday, and we'll see what happens.
If we ever get the Chessant game on, it's the fourth time it's been called off.
Is there anything with Chessant's ground, or is it just that it was just shit weather? I mean, just waterlogged pitch. Yeah,
the pitch is normally okay. I've been there when it's been chucking it down, and it's been fine. I think it's just been so wet this year.
Yeah.
Yeah, it has been more than usual, isn't it? You know.
Yeah, it always seems to be. Match day as well, doesn't it? Like, you can be fine for the few days beforehand, or suddenly actually tips it down the morning of the game.
Right then. Okay.
We'll see what happens.
Okay. Yeah. We've got Chatham, which could be an interesting game because,
bit of a grudge match, eh?
Yeah. And so things happened last game at the Chatham game. Yeah. So, hopefully none of that happens.
Pitch, mate. It might actually work in your favour. Because, I mean, they like to play sort of quick football on the floor, especially on their surface, don't they? So you bring them sort of down to that now to use your pitch. Who's to say?
Yeah, no, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, again, it's a cracking set of fixtures this Saturday. So it's going to be a good week. Exciting week, no matter what.
Business end of the season, isn't it?
Yeah, this is fun times now. Or sad times. Who knows? Who knows? But listen, thank you very much, Ian, John and Terry. Thanks for coming on. And see you at the game. Yeah? Yeah.
Definitely.
Guys, take care, yeah?
See ya.
Take care, bye.
That's it for another episode, SBTS fans. If you want to get in contact with this podcast, the email is hufcpod@gmail.com. Twitter, which is SBTSpod. Otherwise, go to the YouTube. Over 3.5 years of content on there. There's so many other ways to listen. However you get your podcast, we're on all platforms. Or go to the link tree, which is SBTSpodcast, and subscribe. It's all free. Remember, get yourselves to a game and support local football, whoever and wherever you're watching. And apart from that,
See you at the game.